I'd really like to thank my panelists for being up here. A couple years ago, or maybe even a year ago, I know I sat down with Ed and Phil and I said, you know, we really need to put something together to help our membership understand if they decide to grow or expand, or if they're in a challenged area in the state, what do they need to do, or how do they do it, or who do they need to talk to, or where do they start? And so through that, Matt and his staff have helped us put this panel together to maybe answer some of those questions, or maybe give you some clarity or give you some options as far as the future goes. So when you look at the panelists here, I'm going to introduce them real quick. We've got Ken
Hessenius,
and I always have a challenge with that. You know, Ken grew up in Mallard area in Palo Alto County, Northwest Iowa, on a family farm raising crops and livestock. He has a BA from Buena Vista, an MA in Moncato State, and 34 years experience in the natural resources. For the last 25 years, Ken has been with the IDNR, and he's been a real asset to us as we've gone down this path and started to communicate, you might say, when we look at what's happened with the relationship between the Iowa Department of Natural Resources, EPA, and Iowa cattlemen. David Trowbridge, a 1976 graduate of UNL. He manages the Gregory Feedlot for the past 38 years. Raises Hereford and Angus seed stock with his wife Mary, and he's been a director on the American Hereford Board. So again, thank you, David, for coming here. And I think what you're going to see with our panelists is that all of us here have a different operation. We're going to give you different scenarios as we go along here. Mike Sexton. Mike was elected to the Senate in 1998. In 2000, he was appointed to the Senate National Resource Environmental Committee. And today, him and his wife have the Twin Lakes Environmental Services, focused on writing manure management plans. Comprehensive nutrient management plans permit writing for livestock operations and assure good placement of barns, and producers understand the law and regulations that encompass them. Mike has been a technical service provider since 2003. And just in the past year or so, Mike is now back on the Republican side of the House. And Mike, congratulations again, and thank you for being there and all the work that you do for us on the Hill. So again, thanks, Mike. Ed, I asked Ed for a bio. Here's Ed's bio. I have a feedlot at Gregory, Iowa. Any questions? So, and you're a past president of ICA. Yes, yes, he asked me to say that too. So all that being said, Ed, thanks for being here and being part of this, because I think what you're going to see from, especially the three of us producers, is that we've all got different operations here. Two of us are permitted, one of us is not, and we're going to let you kind of go through. I've got a few questions to ask them to get started, and we're going to kind of give a short update and let them get up and speak first to kind of give maybe some background and what they'd like to talk about. But first, I'd like to take this minute again to thank, is there anybody else here from the DNR, Ken, that you've seen? Oh, they're working the booth. Well, I hope everyone stops by and at least introduces yourself to Iowa Department of Natural Resources. It's been an interesting road. The last 20 years, we've really made it a mainstay for the Iowa cattlemen to develop a relationship where we can sit at the table and have those discussions. And we all understand that if you're not at the table, you're on the menu. And I don't think it's that way anymore with the Cattlemen's Association, especially in Washington, D.C. now, as we look at what's happened with there and Region 7. We've got a relationship today where we can talk and we can visit. They call us today and ask for information, which never used to happen before. So, Ken, thank you for that work that we've done together, and we're going to continue to work together. I want to explain the picture here. I hope everybody did cheer for the Iowa football team the other day. I did. What's that? Okay. I did, but a couple years ago they had one of these contests at the Iowa State University where dress your pet. And so we were going home from a football game, and Nancy and I had seen enough dogs, kittens, turtles, and bunnies dressed in Iowa State gear. So we went to the feedlot, and do you think out of 5,200 head you could find one calf that would stand still, you could dress like this? So we went to the neighbors, took their show heifer, and wouldn't you guess we won the thing that year. So the beef industry is strong at Iowa State University. Real quick, I want to kind of go through my scenario here because it's going to mine has a piece of about the other two that are here, and it'll kind of help get things kicked off here. But I want to take you on a little history ride. This is around 1925 to 1930, we think. This is my feedlot back at the turn of the century. As you can see, we've got a mound. Elmer was a future farmer of America, and so he flew all over the United States in a little tail dragger airplane. And the only thing today at our feedlot left there is the house. And the reason I'm going to show these is because this has happened on most of the feedlots here in this part of the country. Farmer feeders have taken these operations, and we've grown them, and we've tried to conform to the rules and regulations that have come along. 1966, you can see that all of a sudden we've got some new grain storage here. We've got a silo. We've got a barn off to the right there. Those barns turned out to be death traps, you know, if the wind wasn't in the right direction, you didn't have some ventilation. But anyway, that was the time of the century, and we now have some concrete there. 1985, as you can see, it's expanded off to the east. But as you can also see, we've got some issues. We've got some water standing on the side. Where does the water go when it comes off of there? Where does it run to? And I think at that time we were under the amnesty project, where we had a 10-year time frame to get our feedlots in compliance, or at least come up with a plan to help understand where our runoff was going to. 2004, we decided to go into the alternative technology project with Department of Natural Resources and EPA. And so you can see on both sides there we have VIBs, and then at the bottom here VTAs, and we have settling basins. But we also still have the mounds with the aprons. So we've basically got two different types of feedlot here to help control runoff. In 2008, we decided to put up our first monoslope barn, which you can see up to the top there. So now we're up to three different types of feeding situations here, and what is working best. And as you all know, when you live in central Iowa with the soil type that we have, the saying that we've got on our farm is when it's muddy, it's only ankle deep if it goes in head first, because that black soil will not hold an animal up. And then this is what we look like today. So we are just one of the many cattle producers in the state that have tried to go forward, stay in compliance, make sure that we capture that runoff and be able to utilize all the nutrients in that runoff, because those nutrients have a value, and that's very important to us. So when you look at what's happened in a century of progress, this is what's happened on our farm, and as it has all across the state and the country. So we hope through today's panel discussion here, when you leave and you'll go out and you'll be able to walk around your fences and say, okay, what do I need today to be part of this, to be able to comply and to be able to protect the environment, but also to stay profitable. So I think first I'd like to introduce David. And David, I'll kind of let you talk here for a little bit. If you want to stay there, I've got two pictures for David, or if you want to come up here and run the, why don't you come up here? And you can kind of go through and tell about your operation, and then Ed, I'll let you get up and talk about your operation. And David is permitted, and Ed is not permitted, so.
Good morning. I've been the manager at Gregory's since I got out of college and running the feedlot. We actually have two locations. We have two open lots about 3 miles apart. One is permitted for 5,500 head and one is permitted for 2,000 head. They both have permits, and we were part of the original project for the AT project with Bill, and I think there were six of us that worked with the DNR on that project about 10 years ago. So we have two permits, and we control everything goes down through settling basins. In our feedlots are both on quite steep slopes of hills. One feedlot has about 20 acres of feedlot all open, with mounds and drains into two settling basins, and then goes into a VTA, which is terraced off with distributor strips through it, throughout the base of the VTA, so that the water is distributed evenly across the VTA and flows. We have about 40 acres of grass below that feedlot. It all goes through a gated irrigation pipes out of the basins and then is distributed through there on an even flow, so we get good spread of the water through the grass. The other feedlot, the main feedlot, 5,500 head, is got seven basins below the feedlot where we handle all the settling. That goes into about 40 acres of grass there. It's probably not as good as the 20 acres on 40 acres of grass, but it does handle it. We've had that set up for 8 years, and we've been able to, other than the first year where we had 2 8-inch rains, until this summer in late August was the first time we had a 7-inch rain where we had to have a release out of the VTAs. So the permits have been very useful for us. Handling the manure, we don't have to handle liquid. We only handle solids. So we use that all on our ground. We farm about 4,000 acres of ground, and we put 20 tons of manure per acre on about 1,500 acres of ground every year. So that's pretty much what we, our operation and the way that works. So we'll let Ed take over and run with his. He's got better pictures than I do.
I have none. I'll have to apologize. I did not bring any pictures. But I'm going to tell you that my operation, along with my brother and our wives, is a lot like many in the state of Iowa. The state of Iowa, as we know, is full of cattle production type businesses that are very, very different. When you travel across the state, you do not see a bunch of cookie cutter designs of buildings that are built in the same place, or feedlots that are built in the same slope. And so Iowa is very unique in that way. In fact, in all my travels with the National Cattlemen, everybody's always intrigued by what's going on in Iowa. We know that that half of our cattle on feed in the state of Iowa are in the under 1,000 head yards. And so I would say that our operation is a lot like many yards in the state of Iowa, in that I have cattle at four different sites. At these four different sites, we have all the different production models that are out there. We've got one site that we built some hoop buildings on because we needed to take care of some issues. We didn't want to spend a lot of money on the site. We wanted to get another 10 years out of the site, and so we just tried to find a way to use some existing concrete and put up some sheds so that we could use the site for a while. We have a site at my dad's place where I grew up that is very is your typical site that was built in the 1960s and the 70s. There's concrete poured around the silo. They had all these plans of putting an automated bunk system in. And so we've had to do retrofitting there where we've got fence line bunk now. But it's a site that the life of it is probably starting to come to an end. We've got these decisions made on what to do with the old concrete, and we've had to make some changes there. What really brought me into the light of having to deal with the DNR is when I decided at my home place to go over 1,000 head. When I made that decision, I hired Mike and his wife Becky to help me put together the plan and to apply for the construction permit. I hired Stu and Brad to do the engineering work. And at the point in time when we did that, I was not completely covered in my buildings. I had some outside pens, no cattle on dirt at my place, but we were not going to cover all the pens. The plans was to build a deep bedded monoslope building. When I put together my plan, we put together the plan as though I was going to get an NPDES permit. What we were trying to figure out to do is, what are we going to do with the water that comes off of these open concrete pens? What about the water that comes off of the feed, you know, where we load the feed truck, where the silage and the corn pile is? And so we put together a plan where we would catch that water. And after we sent the plan into the DNR to apply for the NPDES permit and the construction permit, Paul Petiti came back to us and says, it just doesn't look like Ed needs an NPDES permit. So with that in mind, we hung on to that email, but we made the decision that we're going to build some controls anyway. So we went ahead and built the controls that we were going to build as though we were getting an NPDES permit. it was just a little bit cheaper to do it because, of course, I didn't have to have an engineer signing off on it all. So I took the route at my place when we went over 1,000 head that, yes, we're going to cover the build, cover the cattle. We're going to put buildings over everything. But we're going to catch all the water that comes off of the yard, comes off of the floor where we load the truck. And just to keep me from getting in trouble, because we all know that when you do not have an NPDES permit, you shall not discharge. And so that's kind of the attitude that I have taken at my place, is that we're going to do whatever it takes not to discharge. Now, at those facilities that are, I have two of them that are 500 head, we've done some different things. We've pushed up some dirt. We've made some big grass areas for water to go into. And I've tried to use a lot of common sense. I've taken Mike with me to go look at those spots. I've taken other people to, the coalition went with me one day to take a look at where our cows are running. And I'm using the attitude of common sense, in that if there's an area where water's going and nothing wants to grow and it looks a little bit ugly, maybe we need to do something. Maybe there's something not right here. Maybe we need to change something. So we're trying to do a lot of big areas that have grass where the water's running into and it can filtrate through in those places that are under 1,000 head. So I think what I'm trying to say is that I know you all have lots of different facilities that are not cookie cutter, that are, you really can't explain to anyone until they come and look at them. Hire somebody. Get another set of eyes out there. You've maybe looked at them for 20 years. Get somebody new to come out there and take a look at it. When I was showing Mike where our cows were at, I was under the assumption that where the cows were coming up for winter feeding, we don't have to do anything with. And this was his comment. He said, "Ed, it looks like a feedlot, smells like a feedlot. Maybe it is a feedlot." And so we made some changes. We made some changes where these cows are coming up to, so that we could really kind of keep ourselves from getting in trouble. And so that's kind of the attitude that we've taken when we've done that. But I would say it again, is get another set of eyes on it. It doesn't cost that much to do it, to have them come out and take a look.
Thanks, Ed. And one thing I want to reiterate what Ed said is use common sense. You know, not everybody needs a permit here. And with that in being said, we need to take someone like Mike around. And Mike, I'd like to have you come up and just give a quick 101 on permit issues, what you're hearing from people, the questions that are asked, and where do you start the conversation?
So thank you, Bill. Well, typically the conversation, somebody will call the office. First of all, the owner of Twin Lakes Environmental Services, my wife, Becky. You can wave her hand. So if you have questions at the end of this, she's actually the big cheese in the office. I just work for her. So, but anyway, typically the phone will ring, and it'll be a cattle producer, and it'll say, "Mike, I don't know if I need to do something or not." And then I said, "Well, let's talk about it." And at the end of the day, one of the simplest things is, does the water leave your site? And that pretty much takes care of everything. If you can tell me that as long as you've raised cattle there, that when it rains 3 inches or 4 inches, that water, if it leaves your yard, it goes into 80 acres and it sits there. Yeah, it's kind of, when you're doing these kind of conversations, it's kind of a different language, and it's confusing for you because it's confusing for us, but it's kind of a DNR EPA language. And if you're over 1,000 or under 1,000, so then that's one of the first things we have to get out of the way. But the next thing is, as you all understand, it's all about the water. It's all about the runoff. So if you can keep that water on your property and you're less than 1,000 head, you know, even we've got some folks, you know, Ed's a good example. We have some other folks that have cattle that aren't all under roof, that don't have NPDES permits. Depends on your topography. If it's flat, that water leaves your yard, it goes out into 80 acres, and there's not an intake in the middle of the pond. You know, and your dad's raised cattle there for 60 years, and you're raising cattle there, and you've never had that water get away from you, probably don't need an NPDES permit. But if that water leaves your yard and it goes to a road ditch, it goes to a waterway and gets to a creek, goes to an intake, we probably need to talk. And even if the intake is, you know, 40 rod out into the middle of your 80 acres, and you think, well, nobody's ever going to see that get there, Folks, in our office, we use ARC, all the ARC View products and ARC Desktop. We can lay on top of a computer screen aerial imagery from 2002 up to 2014. We can lay LIDAR on top of that aerial imagery of your feedlot. LIDAR shows contours, 2-foot contours. So once I find your feedlot, I can lay aerial imagery on there, I can lay LIDAR on there, and before I ever come to your feedlot, I can tell you where that water leaves your feedlot. I can tell you it goes underneath the fence 435 feet from your mailbox. So don't think that we can't see what's going on, because if I can do it, Ken can do it, the EPA can do it. So we know where that water's going. So my takeaway message, and I don't want to stand up here and lecture all day, because I know you're going to have some questions, we'll get to some of that, is the most important thing to know is where your water goes, where your runoff water goes. And if it leaves your site and goes into a grass waterway and you think that's okay, it might be okay, depending on where your grass waterway ends up. If it goes up and ends up out into your field somewhere and your waterway just ends up there, you know, you might be okay. But if your waterway goes a quarter mile and dumps into the little, you know, no-name creek, if it's got banks in a bottom, Ken regulates that. So, in fact, we've got some waterways. If you got an old waterway that's been cut and it's got banks in a bottom, you could be in trouble there. So there's a lot of things that we need to look at. And that's one of the things that we do, is look at a lot of open feed yards and just make sure you are compliant. So with that, I will get out of the way.
Thanks, Mike. Next, I'd like to have Ken get up here and basically talk about the pros and cons of a permit. Basically, two questions. That's the first one, and how you want to do this in either order doesn't matter to me. And then how are we coming on the inspections? You know, how many do we have left? How many have you done? I think you started with the high-risk ones first on both sides of the 1,000-head number. And can you kind of give us an update where you're at in the office and 101?
Thank you, everyone. I know a lot of the faces out there, so appreciate you listening in. Been at this a long time, seen everything. So like Mike said, you know, you just can't hide anymore with all the imagery. We don't have planes or drones, but we do have aerial photographs, and they show a lot. So let me start out with where we're at in the work plan. That was signed auspiciously enough September 11th of 2013, so we're about halfway through the work plan. That calls for inspections of all feedlots that meet the EPA medium CAFO, or medium AFO definition. Open lots do have a higher priority because they are exposed to rainfall events, and Bill mentioned where we're at. I think as of today, we're right about 50%. It's probably higher for the open lots, but I don't have that data. So if you've got 300 head and over and haven't been in 300 head beef cattle and over and haven't been inspected yet, you will either get a letter or you'll get a call and a visit. So most of those have been very educational for everyone. We have not penalized anyone on a visit yet. So now if you were required to do something and we come back in 2 years, nothing's been done, then maybe something else will happen. But that's where we're at, Bill, with the work plan. I'll take questions on that. I don't want to expound too much on that today. A little bit about NPDES permits and the pros and cons. I don't have the exact number, Reza's not here, but it's something like 170 statewide right now. We've actually lost two or three in the last year, and we permitted a couple, so it's been kind of steady. About 110 of those are in my region up in northwest Iowa, so that's where the cattle are. Most of the rest of them are in southwest Iowa, so there's probably only about 20 NPDES permits in two-thirds of the state. So the cattle industry largely congregated over in the western part. Let me give you some of the pros. It is an NPDES permit, it's a mouthful, but in that is discharge. Okay, if you have a permit, by federal law, you are allowed to discharge. And that's with a caveat, though, you have to operate and maintain your facilities. So if you're required to empty after a rainfall event and you don't, and it rains again and it runs over, you don't have that protection. So make sure you, if you do have that NPDES permit, follow the permit, keep good records, and you're in good shape. So you do have that permit to discharge. You are protected both 25-year, 24-hour event, and chronic rainfall events. And you all have been around. Rains don't always come in 5.2 inches per event. They come 1 inch a day later, 2 inches 2 days later, 3 inches. That's a chronic rainfall event. You are protected against that also. One thing that's not widely known is you're also granted what we call an agricultural stormwater exemption. That's a big one. And what that means for the most part is if you apply your manure according to your permit and you get a rainfall event and it washes some of that manure off, you are protected. If you don't have the permit, you are not protected. Okay? That's a big one. A lot of people don't think about that. We've got environmental groups just buzzing around our office and around your farms waiting to sue somebody. They've already, we all well know about the Des Moines Water Works lawsuit, and they're just ready for doing that when they can. So you do get protection, and this is the third thing. You get protection from those citizen lawsuits if you operate and maintain according to your permit. So those three things, you have a permit to discharge, ag stormwater exemption, and protection from citizen lawsuits. And they will come, no doubt. One final thing to note, if you choose, as Ed did, not to get a NPDES permit, I'm not up here advocating those. I'm just telling you what the benefits are. If you're comfortable controlling your runoff without a permit, you know, I'm all for it. It's a lot of work for everyone, but there are good reasons to get that. But if you're over 1,000 head, what do you need in the state of Iowa, Ed? No, no. You need an NMP.
Oh, yeah.
Right. So even if you don't get the NPDES permit, Iowa law requires all those over 1,000 head to have an NMP. So you still get, and that's about 75% of what you need to get an NPDES permit is the NMP. So with that, a myriad of questions, I'm sure, and I'm not going to take any more time to explain the regs. We'd have to have a conference in itself. So, Bill, that hopefully will trigger some questions.
Thanks, Ken. Is Gene Tinker in here by any chance? Oh, okay. Well, I threw this question out to Gene, too, because, you know, as you well know, Gene has probably been at every cattleman's convention we've had as long as he's been old enough to come to one. And, you know, he made a statement here that I thought was very profound, and I needed to read it, and I'll go through it real quickly. He says, you know, one of the things that needs to be stressed is what it takes to get a permit. I really get irritated when folks talk about getting a permit. Getting a permit doesn't do anything to protect the environment. It is the control structures that must be built in order to get the permit that actually protects the environment when operated correctly. And the permit stresses that what must be done to correctly operate the control structures in order to get the protection and that the permit provides. Which leads me to my second point. Reading and understanding the permit says what the producer must do to comply with that permit. If you don't understand what you're required to do, it is difficult to do it correctly. Understanding why things must be done should help a producer accept the importance of meeting these requirements in the permit. If there is anything someone does not understand about their permit, they need to make a call to someone who helped them understand those permits, DNR staff, ISU Extension, outreach staff, or their engineer. The permit isn't a simple checkbox that you have one. It's understanding the requirements and the importance of those requirements. And the final note that he puts down is, all work is done at the DNR is completed by people. Sometimes people make mistakes. If there's something in that permit that doesn't seem and needs, if there's something in that permit that does not make sense, it needs to be discussed because there is a chance a mistake was made. So the DNR can be made aware of the corrections and maybe something can happen from that. So I think that's very important to understand too. I have to, is your wife here, Ed? Is Cindy here? Didn't Nancy? You know, one thing we're very fortunate here in this group is that Ed's wife and my wife sit on the Environmental Protection Commission, and they're truly, you know, advocates for us, and they help us through that. But you got to remember, they're sitting on there just to help make policy and make sure that these rules are followed corrections. And I want to read something that Nancy put down. She says, you know, my wife Nancy reports that every month in public comment, the concerned citizens of Iowa comment that all livestock producers should be regulated, inspected, and have clean water permits. It is tempting to underestimate this group, as they often seem misinformed on the issues. Let's not forget they have alliances with national organizations, and that is how you now have 7 new inspectors at the IDNR, through the newest weapon of their arsenal, litigation. So I think it's very important that we understand, as Ken said, there's people out there looking, and they're ready. I mean, where I live in central Iowa, there's basically 3 feedlots in Story County. And believe me, when you live on a major highway, they're all watching and what's gonna happen there. I'm gonna open this up for questions real quick, but Ken, first I'd like to ask you, how are you getting along with the 7 new inspectors? Is everybody on the same page? And one thing I like that Chuck Gipp says whenever he gets up in front of a group is he says, you know, it used to be find and fine, and that's not the way it is today. As Ken said, they're out there trying to help us get there. They're making the visit. We do the walk around. Don't be afraid of it. Call ICA. Take one of the staff with them. Call the coalition. Take one of the coalition with you. It's out there to just figure out what's going on. So, Ken, how are you getting along with the new inspectors, and are things going quite well? I didn't mean to put words in your mouth, but...
Okay. All right. Thanks. I'm going to embarrass a couple of my staff members that slipped in the back. In fact, you asked earlier, DNR was here. 2 of the environmental folks up in Northwest Iowa, Brandon Miner, I think, and Lois Benson, and our communications guru, Kevin Baskins, who puts out all those press releases. So. Regarding the 7, there was an appropriation from the Iowa legislature to commit to getting those work plan inspections done. 7 FTEs were hired, but some were new, but some of that money is rolled into existing inspectors. So we have something like 35, 40 people actually doing the inspection. So it's not like there's just 7 new staff out doing them. But the other part of the question is, yes, we're on the same page. We work very hard to stay on the same page so that what Lois sees is the same thing Brandon sees, is the same thing Allison Mann sees when she goes down to visit other feedlots. So I think we're doing a pretty good job of that. You know, I'm kind of watching that from afar. So if you do get an inspection and have a question, don't be afraid to ask those questions. So we're trying to be on the same page. We've all had the same training. EPA's been involved with that. A lot of good things are happening with that. We're meeting in February to standardize those inspections. We have SOPs. The whole works has been laid out. So long answer to a short question, Bill.
At this point, I'd like to open it up for questions. I don't have a mic, so if you'd speak quite loudly so we can all hear. I'll open the floor for questions.
The last rule package the ENR submitted, it's about a half inch thick, and that piece is in there. And there's a lot of us in agriculture that are in the legislature that hate that piece. It doesn't make sense. I don't know if there's a producer out here that will, if this is the rationale, if the price of corn is lower, you're going to put on less fertilizer because you don't need to grow as much crop. And how many of you want to do that? Yeah, see, exactly. There's not a producer that doesn't want it when they get up in the morning and they go to the field. They don't want to get as much as they can for the least amount of inputs, but still at the end of the day, they want to have the best yield they can get. So that rationale doesn't make any sense. When we saw that in the rule package, we didn't like it. I just had a conversation with some folks, and I think the DNR is going to pull that piece out of the rule package because we don't like that piece in there. And so then take it to the next step, which is Becky and my step. So the price of nitrogen is you know, 45 cents a unit today. I'm just pulling numbers out of the air here. And so, okay, that says that we're going to have less of the yield, so we're going to build a nutrient management plan, you know, on those numbers, and then all of a sudden the price of corn goes from $3.50 to $5. Well, now we're going to put on more nitrogen because we're going to have more corn to sell. So now we're going to change the nutrient management plan. We could be changing the nutrient management plan 4 or 5 times a year based on the price of corn. So that. And we pinned Iowa State down, and Iowa State now is kind of backed up and said that the rationale behind that might not be the best either. So I'm very confident we're going to get that piece pulled out of the rule package.
The question was, as you're involved in these permits, are you required to do continuing education in a certain amount of time frame?
The short answer is no. There's no certification requirement for having a permit. Stretching that a little bit, if you have confinements and you do manure application from it other than a small animal feeding operation, you do need certification to apply manure. So if you have a cattle confinement, then you would need some sort of certification. But for NMP, NPDES, you do not.
Well, I should probably let Ken answer this, but the question is on deep-bedded barns and stockpiling manure. I'll go a little ways, Ken, and then I'll let you take it the rest of the way. Basically, I think if I've read the rules right, and what we do is a stockpile is good for 6 months. You know, we try to put those stockpiles, I mean, it goes back to what Ed says, common sense, out of sight, out of mind. Get those stockpiles out into a field where if you do have an event, that water, if there is some runoff from that stockpile, it's going to go into the cornfield. Or it's going to work around the cornfield. I'm going to let you go from there, Ken, and kind of explain stockpiles and deep-bedded barns, rules and regulations.
Yeah, we do have rules on stockpiles. There's different rules for different kinds of stockpile. Deep-bedded has its own set of rules, but your question also, and I didn't hear it completely, involved the land application of the stockpile. What was that question? We'll go two routes with that question. If you have an NMP, it has to be land applied according to your NMP at whatever rate that the NMP says. So if it's 20 tons per acre, then if you apply it that, then you're, if you do have an NPDES permit, then you've got that stormwater exemption. And that's kind of what I mentioned earlier. If you don't have that permit and you do get a catastrophic rainfall event, you don't have that agricultural stormwater exemption. So,
well, in the break, what Ken was saying, in the break for that would be 500 head. So, if you have 500 head in confined, so if you had a 300 head deep bedded building and a 200 head deep bedded building, now you've thrown yourself into needing a manure management plan, and then you have to follow whoever put your plan together is your 18 ton per acre, whatever that number is, then you're going to be held to that. So if you stayed under the 500, then you're a safe-o and you can go out and, you know, spread ever how you want, so.
I'll comment a little bit on it. So I apply based on, you know, we updated mine actually this year so that I could change how much I apply, but I apply based on what we're removing and kind of what the farm needs. But the other thing I will say I do in terms of applying the manure is timing. We take a look at all of our fields, and the fields in the fall that have cricks through them are full of intakes and are going to, we try to get those applied in the fall and get that worked in, because in the wintertime, as we know, on frozen ground, we've got to stay away from those any waters or any intakes. And so we try to use our judgment and save the farms that we're going to apply on in the winter that are really flat, and we don't have a lot of fear of the water leaving them.
And currently, there are no rules against applying solid manure in the wintertime. That's liquid. That rule affects liquid manure, and there's no regulations on solid manure, although that bill comes out of the, it'll come out of the Senate every year, you know, to impose regulations on solid manure, so.
One other thing about stockpiles is you have to be cognizant of is there is a regulation as far as distance from a house or a building site. And so, and the distances are different if it's an open feedlot or if it's a deep bedded barn. I know in my permit they are. So we have to be very careful and cognizant of where those stockpiles are put just due to distances. I think it's 1,250 feet on a stockpile, and that's a quarter of a mile. So just one other thing you need to look at. David, if you had to do it all over again, would you do an AT system? I think we need to start talking about the different systems that are out there. Well, an AT system is an alternative technology, and let me kind of go through what that is. Basically, we go into a settling basin when we have a runoff event. The nutrients attach themselves to the solids, and they settle to the bottom. And in my system, I have a VIB, a vegetative infiltration basin, where that's water that is released out into that. It's tiled underneath that. And the grasses utilize part of the nutrients that go down through the soil profile. It's captured by a tile, brought back up, and run through a VTA. And David, yours is just a settling basin and a VTA.
Yes.
So explain some of the challenges you've had with that, because we're trying to get many different types of systems here that you could use.
When we looked into this several years ago, putting in an AT system rather than a regular lagoon system, we were looking at, you know, collecting water off of approximately 50 acres into one lagoon, which would have been in our area where we have average 37 inches of moisture a year, would have been a lot of water to handle every year. This system has worked well for us in our situation because we have enough ground below our feedlot where we could control the water and infiltrate it into grass area and then harvest that grass and use that back into the feedlot again as roughage. We would do it again, I believe, just because we don't have to handle that water, and we can handle dry manure much more efficiently and spread it over a larger area of ground than having an irrigation system to manage the water through the feedlots. It does have a few more regulations and a few more details to manage than a lagoon system does. We do quite a bit of record keeping, quarterly reports, test well monitoring. Some of it's the same, part of it's different. But we've been pretty happy with it, the way it works. We haven't had any real issues with the DNR or EPA over the years as far as managing it and handling it. I will say that one of the things we're talking about is getting help. Stu and his group helped us set that up several years ago. It took quite a bit of work to get our system put together. We've worked with a lot of different people on helping us manage it. We try to manage it in-house. It does become quite a bit of record keeping and management to keep track of all the details. Follow your, as was mentioned earlier, making sure you do all the details that are on your permit and following those specifically. But over the years, we've made some changes in it. We've worked with the DNR and, you know, asked him about changes in our system and how to make it better. And we've never had an issue with that as far as if it was a better, it was an improvement, they were 100% behind us, and we've had a good relationship with them. So the system works good for us. And as we were talking, in Iowa, there's so many different situations that it's amazing. What works for me may not work for you, but it's worked well for us.
Yeah, they call that pilot program, and they were permitted originally, I think, for 2 or 3 years. And then, you know, they ran the model, went through the testing, and then those permits were extended to full 5-year permits now. I don't know, fortunately or unfortunately, depending on your, we haven't had a AT system built with a permit since that original group, to my knowledge. I'm not quite sure why. It does take a significant land base to do that, and I think that has a little bit to do with it, especially when land and crop prices the way they were. But yes, I believe they're very successful. And frankly, I'd like to see more of them. The smaller lots, it's something to really take a look at if you're under 1,000 head. You know, those can be great systems if they're engineered and operated. So we got a meeting a little later about AT system. We want to try to revive that a little bit, if you will. But we just have not seen much producer push for more of these, and I'm not quite sure why.
I'm going to expand on that, just what Ken talked about. In fact, I was going to talk about it, and then Ken brought up his point. But we have Becky has a client in Calhoun County who Lois drove by and saw some things, and she didn't like it, and it needed to be addressed. But if you're a small open feedlot, which or medium, all this terminology. So if you're over 300 head, this is a, you know, a little over 300 head runoff getting into a road ditch, getting into a tile. And so we contacted Stu, and we designed some alternative technology there. We built 3 small basins. We've tiled underneath it, put the tile in, and it's working really well. So some more options when you're not over 1,000 head, when you're a medium animal feeding operation. You know, this operation doesn't need a nutrient management plan, a manure management plan. They didn't have to get a permit. We took the engineering. It's fully engineered by Doc over there, and it had to be approved by the DNR, and it was approved, and we got it constructed. And so, you know, as we were talking about here, that, you know, if you get the full blown permit, there is some substantial record keeping that goes along with that. And so this kind of alternative controls the water, and the producer doesn't have a bunch of record keeping to do, or he doesn't have to follow a manure management plan, but yet we got the runoff under control. So there, when you leave here, I think knowing there are a lot of options that you have at your disposal. It's not, oh man, I'm going to have to get a permit and go through all this stuff. I think you've heard up here where there's not a lot of permits in the state of Iowa. There's a lot of things we can do, you know, to control runoff besides get a permit.
And I think that's very important, what Mike just said, is that there's been a lot of things that's happened the last 10 years through the AT system, and I know Minnesota probably has the majority of the AT systems out there. So there's and there's a lot of options to the AT system as far as you know, settling basins and vegetative infiltration basins and the VTAs. So there are options out for you. They're economical. You know, it's about you. I challenge all of you to go home and walk around your feedlot. I mean, you know where it's running off. You know what's happening there. I think it's also important that we understand that we help our neighbors when we see some of those things that are happening that I know Nancy and I were riding motorcycles one day and all of a sudden my helmet went like this and she goes, look. And you know, do you pull in and say something? Well, no, I guess we didn't that time. But you know, how do we help self-police ourselves? And I think that's one thing that's really helped us through the relationship that we have with the Department of Natural Resources today, that we are trying to monitor ourselves and make sure that when we see those issues out there, that we're trying to help our friends and neighbors address those. Closing, I guess we'll wrap this. Any other questions? I think we'll wrap this up. Let's just have a few comments from each. Ed, closing comments?
The comment I would have is don't be scared of any of this, and you've got to get somebody to give you a hand. It gets much easier. At first, it's very complicated, the paperwork. You've got to hire somebody that can kind of take you through that and gives you a roadmap of what you're about to do.
Well, I think I probably made my closing comments to what I just talked, is that, you know, we have a lot of options now that, you know, one of the things that I always end up saying is that, folks, ladies and gentlemen, it's a lot easier to work with Ken and the Iowa Department of Natural Resources than it is to work with the United States EPA. Becky and I have both been to inspections, Iowa DNR inspections and EPA inspections, and I tell you what, they're night and day different. So the DNR will work with you. They'll give you the opportunity to correct your problems, to move forward. The United States EPA wants it fixed yesterday. And so moving forward, we need to, if you've got a problem or you sense you have a problem, you know, don't, it's chances are it's not gonna go away. We need to look at it. My other hat, I'll just put in a plug for Mike Sexton, a legislator. Let me know if you have issues with the DNR, and you probably won't, but the EPA, let me know. I put my name on the ballot so I could serve the folks and agriculture. My wife and I farm besides what we do, and her business is, we're entrenched in agriculture. That's just about all we do, so it's very dear to our hearts. So if you have a problem, let me know and see if we can take care of it.
Well, what I would like to say is sort of what Ed said was, this is all about relationships and developing a relationship with the people that can help you, your engineers, your tech service people, and the DNR and the EPA, working with all of them and maintaining a relationship with them and not being afraid to communicate with those people, because over the years we have employed a lot of help to help us with ours. I mean, we're working with a 5,500 head alternative technology system, which I think is probably the largest in the state as far as the number of cattle in that permit. And we've made a lot of changes. We've learned a lot. But it's all about relationships with who you're working with and how you make those changes and how you communicate with the people that are involved. So we're going to have an inspection of our facility on Monday. So I may change my mind after Monday. But you know, in the past, it's been a very good relationship. And we consider them a partner. We thought before we got these permits that we were doing a good job and, you know, maintaining the environment at a very good level, because we were kind of doing the VTA before we started. But with the system works now, we know that we are not polluting. We know that we're controlling all the manure, all the runoff, 100%. We can guarantee that, and it's a good feeling to have that permit and be able to say that we're doing what we're supposed to be doing.
A couple quick comments. I think some of the folks alluded to that. I was going to pick on the staff, but they slipped out the back door, and I was going to have you turn around and look at them and say they really aren't scary. In fact, the two that were here, you know, born, raised on farms, and you know, as I was too. So you know, we understand where you're coming from, but at the end of the day, we have a job to do too, so we're going to do that. You know, if you haven't been inspected yet, if you're in that group, don't wait for your inspection. Like Mike said, walk around your lot. You know where the water runs. Get a hold of these people, get a hold of the coalition, get to work on it. You know, we might come in 2 years and then the inspection will go, wow, look at that. You know, get busy on your own, make those corrections, because you will get a visit. One more thing about the work plan, maybe not widely known, but we've looked at by aerial every section in the state of Iowa, every one of them. So if you have a feedlot work, you know, we know it's there and we're gonna pay you a visit. So anyway, with that, you know, we'll work together, and it's been a great relationship. I've yet to hear one negative comment from a producer about one of those visits. They may not be tickled to death that they have to do this or that to come into compliance, but at the end of the day, you know, you got to, you got, like Bill said, be at the table or you're going to be part of the lunch. So get to the table. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Well, and I'd just like to say that when you do get that phone call, can I have a show of hands of who all has had their visit in here so far? Raise them up so we can see them. So DNR's been busy, but when you do get that phone call, it's kind of like a tax audit. You're going, oh, you know, here we go. But you have people out there that can help you. Don't be afraid to call the ICA office and say, Matt, I'm going to have a visit. You got somebody that can come out. Or call the coalition, or, you know, call Mike or someone. Don't go out there alone if you don't feel comfortable with it. There's people out there that will go with you on that, and they're going to give you time. They'll make the phone call. It might be a week or 2 weeks. It's kind of like the IRS. They work around your schedule. And, you know, if you have to go out and do a walk around first with someone else, that's fine. Go do it. But it's not the end of the world. But just don't forget that there's people out there between Iowa Cattlemen, the coalition, we look at the engineering staffs that are there to help us through this and protect and make this world better. So if there's no more questions, I really, yes, Mike.
Anything I didn't say, and I think there is one thing that, and this happened to the dairy folks a lot because they just added a few buildings and they added a lactating building here, and so they just add stuff, and that's kind of what's happening now with the beef industry. Is you're putting up you put up a deep bedded building, and then you put up another one, and then all of a sudden you got too many confined spaces, and you should have probably had them. Well, you're not probably you. You should have had a manure management plan and went through some steps before you built your second building, or you've got a combination. You've got some open feedlots and you've got some deep bedded buildings, and all of a sudden you're breaking the law because you should have had a manure management plan or you should have had a construction design statement. And then all of a sudden Ken calls and said, well, we're coming out for an inspection. It's a lot better if you get us out there, because there are some avenues we can take to get you compliant before the Iowa DNR shows up and says, well, you have enough animals, you should have had a manure management plan or a nutrient management plan, or you should have had something and you have nothing. So if you think you're at that threshold, you know, give doesn't have to be us. There's a lot of consulting firms in the state of Iowa, but there are some avenues you can take, and working with the Iowa DNR that says, hey, we realize we probably made a mistake here and we're going to fix that now. That holds Ken up before he comes out and does his inspection. We're going to get you compliant, and then he's going to come out and do the inspection. So it'd be a lot better to have a consultant come out and say, we need to fix this, before Ken comes out and says, wow, you know, you guys should have had this fixed a long time ago. So just want to throw that in there. So.
Well, again, Ken and his staff are going to be around here probably most of the day. I know Paul Petiti from Northwest Iowa up around Okoboji is going to be here too. We've actually got a meeting at 10 o'clock to go over the AT systems. But walk up and introduce yourself, because they are part of our team today. And I see Dave Petty back there. We've worked very hard the past 10 years to make sure that relationship is solid today. So make them feel welcome at our convention here. And I know this evening probably Chuck and Bruce and Bill Aim and everybody's going to be here at the reception this evening. Don't be afraid to walk up and introduce yourself and thank him for the relationship that we've developed over the past 10 years. So the question is how long has the NPDES permit been going on?
Yeah, NPDES permits were as a result of congressional action with the Clean Water Act in 1972. So it's been around for 30, 45 years. So it's nothing new. It's just kind of new to the industry in the last decade and a half. But yeah, it's been around a long time.
The question is that they have two slatted barns, and do they need an NPDES permit?
If you're a total confinement, most we don't have a single permit issued in the state of Iowa to a confinement facility. Do you need one? That's up to your comfort level, but there's about 10,000 producers comfortable with that, mostly in the hog side, but there's a lot of cattle guys with confinements that don't have permits, so you're in good company, I guess. Some of the answer to that is really how much testing and data existed 20 years ago. Unfortunately, we had all this in place and we're doing all of this, but there was no funding or no foresight to do that monitoring. The whole issue with Des Moines Water Works is based on nitrate. A lot of the pollutants coming from cattle runoff really isn't that. So I can assure you from some anecdotal evidence up in Sioux County, many years ago, I went to a couple of feedlots after a rain event in August. The creeks were almost dry, and for 20 miles, it was solid cattle manure. 20 miles. We don't see that anymore. I can assure you the water quality is way better than it was before all this started. That being said, you know, that nitrate issue, we're raising crops in Iowa, and crops need fertilizer, and you know, that's a whole different question. It really is, but there is no doubt in my mind the water quality is many folds better in some areas of the state based on what's been done by the cattle industry. Unfortunately, I don't have a lot of that data to back that up, but don't confuse that with the nitrate issue. That's a whole different question. I'm saying from the cattle industry, now if you go up in my part of the state, and I'm going to preach a little bit here, but and Mike knows this too, but for 30 to 40 years we've known that there's no economic advantage coming to tilling soybean fields, but I can show you parts of the state where every last one of them is black. Now we're talking about silt and we're talking about sediment, and there's a long ways to go out there, folks. We really have a long ways to go with that. You know, I rent my farm out now, and this one thing I told the renter, I said, don't touch the soybean ground. And he doesn't. It's that simple on part of this solution. It really is that simple. And why are they doing it? You know, we had 6 weeks of dry weather up our way, and I saw all those soybean fields getting tilled over, and I just kind of shook my head. And that's a little bit of preaching here, folks, but if we don't do it as agricultural producers, they're going to shove it down our throats. So the water quality is the cattle lots have done a wonderful job, but we got to control that sediment. We got to control the sediment because it carries nutrients, and we got to solve the tile problem. And I've got a farm in Palo Alto County, and I've got several thousand feet of tile too. So, and it dumps in one of those drainage ditches that didn't get sued, but
they're all getting sued.
They're coming. So, I don't. That's the farmer in me talking. But the water quality. Huge issue, and we don't want to turn into a Chesapeake Bay.
I gotta quit. Well, and I don't mean to carry this out, but I think one thing that's very important here is following Secretary Northey's lead is the cover crop thing. I look at what we've done on our farm 3 years ago. We did one field, and it's because somebody paid for it. I mean, we got the money to do it. This year I went in the shed and there was $22,000 worth of rye sitting in the shed. And some of that didn't get applied because of the weather conditions. But you drive around Story County today and you're going to see quite a few green fields out there from this rye that's come up. Especially in the livestock organizations here, I mean, that's something that we can do where you do silage. You know, as soon as you get that silage off, get your manure on, go put a cover crop on, get it green. It's amazing. We're going to have to spend a little money here to be able to help control some of the nitrates and some of the different nutrients that are going into this water, but that's one avenue to do it. And when Ken talks about the dirt washing away and the solids in the ditches, you won't see that around some of these fields in Story County now because of the cover crops. You know, a lot of that rye is only this tall. And when Tim started doing this 2 years ago, I had white knuckles when I was sitting in that corn planter planting in this green stuff that was this tall. And this year we had tremendous yields, and those fields were never tilled. So that $15 you spent in doing that, you would have spent that in tillage or fuel or labor or something. But you all need to look at this cover crop thing. It works, and you're talking from what they call a recreational tiller. I mean, I'm kind of one of those guys that Ken was talking about. You know, it needed to be black in Story County because that's the only way you could farm. This year we didn't hardly till a thing and it worked. So please, when you go home, make that one of the options that you look at for next fall, at least trying it. Well, I want to thank all of you for coming. This really did, I hope you've all learned something. We've got the people here in the room that can help you with those questions. And again, don't be afraid to walk up and introduce yourself to the representatives from the DNR here. Thank goodness you're here, and we appreciate you spending the day with us.